Good morning, and it is a good morning because today Solid Rock Drogheda is, our doors are open once again for public worship. However, as you can see, we are still continuing with our online services as well. And today you are going to hear the same message that our congregation will hear in our building at Ballymakenny Road during the in-person church services. I pray that God will meet with you in every bit as real a way as he's meeting with the people in the church building this day as well. I pray that the Holy Spirit will move mightily in your life, in your heart, and equip you for every good work through the Word of God. May God bless you today. We're going to move into a time of worship now. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, you say that you inhabit the praises of your people. Come now and inhabit these praises, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
I was blind, but things' eyes have been opened. Now I her to tell, for the dry season is over, there is a cloud beginning to snow.
Thank you. Father, in this moment, Lord, we receive your rain. We believe, Lord Jesus, that the dry season is over and that, Lord, the cloud has formed and that rain is coming. I pray in the name of Jesus that the dry season of our hearts, where we're far from you, Lord Jesus, will be far behind us, and that, Lord, your rain will filtrate every part of our being. Lord, bless our communities, bless our nation, Lord Jesus, and let, Lord, your season of rain fall on your people as we seek you with our whole heart. We thank you, Lord, for pouring out your spirit upon us. In Jesus' name, amen.
What do you see when you look into the face of your neighbor? Do you see a stranger? A friend? A foreigner? Or a refugee? Do you see someone to avoid? Someone to hide from? Do you see someone to hate or someone to love? Can you see yourself in their face? Do you see the face of Jesus?
As always, a big thank you to our worship team. Today we are going to do something a little bit different. We are going to pray for the nation of India. We do have, of course, a number of Indian members here in our church at Solid Rock Drogheda, and we want to join with them in prayer now, in praying for this great nation, one of the most populous nations, of course, on earth. You know, we have been so impacted by our Indian members here in Drogheda. They've really brought such blessing and such life and joy and teaching to our church. And we want to pray for India now. India is going through a time of suffering. India is suffering enormously with the pandemic at present. If you've watched any news at all, you will know that that is the case. And so we want to pray for that nation now. I've visited India a number of times myself. I've friends in India who are sick with COVID and some who have died of COVID. And so we want to pray for that nation now. Heavenly Father, we just lift up now the nation of India. Lord, we know that there over the years, there has been so much Christian witness in that land, and there are some incredible churches in that land. But Lord, we know that there's still much darkness, there's still much false religion, and there's still sometimes persecution against the people of God. But Lord, just now we pray for all of the nation of India. Lord, you say that we should do good to all, and especially to the household of faith. And so, Lord, we pray for India now. And in Jesus' name, we ask you to bless this land. We ask you to bring healing. We ask for an amazing and a miraculous turnaround in the situation with COVID, O Lord. We pray that you would halt the plague in Jesus' name. We pray for restoration for the land of India in the name of Jesus. We pray for comfort for those who are bereaved. We pray, Lord, for hope for those who are suffering. And we pray for a mighty release of the Spirit of God across the nation of India. For we pray this now in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. We are going to have a special song in a moment, and we'll come to the word after that. Before we do that, I just want to say that we have a special announcement, which is to do with anyone that's thinking of getting married. We are starting a premarital counseling course, and we would love you to be part of the group that's doing that if you are thinking of getting married in the next year or so. And so if you would like to be part of that group that's taking the premarital counseling course, would you please contact us? Seamus and Bibi Burke are going to be organizing this, and you can contact Seamus at the email address courses courses@solidrock.ie. So that's courses@solidrock.ie. Just email, send an email to that address and just tell Seamus that you would like to be a part of the premarital counselling group, or even just ask for more information if you'd like to find out a bit more about it. Praise God. But now let's listen to our special song. Today we are continuing with our series of teachings. It's the conclusion of our series on spirit-led attitudes. We talked 2 weeks ago about the attitude of gratitude, and then last week we were talking about the attitude of service. Well, today we're going to conclude this series by looking at the attitude of hope. Hope, I think you will find today, is something that we think we know all about, and then discover maybe we didn't understand it quite as well as we thought we did when it comes to a biblical standpoint. But as we've been saying, we need to be led by the Spirit. That's a theme for this year, is led by the Spirit. And that includes our attitudes. And we've been making the point every week that our English word attitude comes from the Latin, or from the Italian, attitudine. And attitudine was a artistic term that a painter or a sculptor would use for the model that they were using, that the model would hold a set position and hold it in place. And so having an attitude, sometimes we use that phrase in a bad way, well, he's got a bit of an attitude, But actually, having a godly attitude is often not something that comes naturally to us, and we have to deliberately set ourselves in position and keep doing that until we find that we take that position more naturally. It becomes second nature to us. And let's look at this attitude of hope. I'm going to start reading from Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Listen to this. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. I hope you got that in verse 23. Let us hold unswervingly. Let us get in the attitude of hope. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess. In the same way as a model for that painting wouldn't be all fidgeting around, but they would unswervingly hold the position, we need to have an unswerving, a dedicated, a resolute attitude of hope. And the problem why maybe we don't always work that out so well in our Christian lives is because hope is one of the most misunderstood concepts in the Bible. Because our English word hope, in ordinary conversation, the way we use that today, is a very weak word. It's a word that's full of uncertainty. You know, if you said to somebody, right, we're going to meet up tomorrow. Now, you're going to be there. Yeah, I'm going to be there. Okay, I'm going to see you at 3:00. And they say, I hope so. I'm going to say, hang on, are we or are we not? You know, I want to know that you're going to be there. This is important. I don't want to hear, well, I hope so. You know, I can't count on that. And so our English word hope, as we use it now, is full of uncertainty. It means I'd like it to happen, but it might not. That's not what the biblical term uses, but that's how we use it in English. If somebody says, well, I hope I win the lottery, they're not saying they expect to win the lottery. In fact, they probably know deep down there's a 1 in a billion chance they're going to win the lottery. But they say, I hope I'll win the lottery. It's like, well, I'm wishing for it. Or I might say, I hope Arsenal will win the Premier League next season. Well, there's not much certainty in that, given what's happened in previous seasons for a long, long time. Now, that's how we use that English word hope. But in the Bible, it's very different. In the Old Testament, in Hebrew, the Hebrew word for hope is tikva. And it has two meanings. Yes, it means hope, but it also means rope. Imagine that. And, you know, it's pure chance that in our language they rhyme, because in Hebrew, you know, you wouldn't expect that. But it's the same word. Hope and rope are both one Hebrew word, tikva. Why is that? Well, it's because as a rope is woven together, a rope is not just one cord, a rope is plaited together. And as that rope is woven together, so in the Hebrew concept of hope, faith and experience are woven together to give you something firm to hold on to. And so in the Hebrew mind, hope was like a rope to a mountaineer. When a mountaineer's going up a mountain, he's got handholds, he's got footholds, he's got the gear, he's got those spikes, what is it, crampons on his boots. But you know what? When all else fails, he's got his rope, and his rope will take his weight. And so the Hebrew concept of hope is something that you can trust on it, that you can You can lean your weight upon it. And that's very, very different from saying, oh, well, I hope I do this or I hope I do that in the way we normally use the word. So this is one reason why we misunderstand biblical teaching about hope, because we're actually using the word very differently these days. You know, that same root word, tikva, comes into Isaiah 40, verse 31, where it says, they that wait upon the Lord. And that word wait is actually comes from the same word as tikva, as meaning hope or a rope. They that wait upon the Lord, or they that hope upon the Lord, or they that see the Lord as their rope that they cling on to, will renew their strength, and they shall mount up with wings like eagles, and they shall run and not grow weary, and they shall walk and shall not faint. Think of a drowning man being thrown a rope when he's in those waves and he's going under and his life is nearly gone, and they throw a rope, and when he grasps that rope, he's got something life-saving, something firm to hold on to. That's how the Hebrews saw hope. Very different from hoping to win the lotto. Now, what about the New Testament? Well, of course, the New Testament was written in Greek, and the Greek word for hope is elpis. And again, this is very different from our English idea of hope as a maybe or a bit of a wish. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and verse 13, 1 Corinthians 13, of course, is the love chapter. We often have that read at weddings. But the final, at the end, 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13, says, and now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Just think about that for a moment. Three things remain. When everything else is gone, when all the other stuff is temporary and done with and over, the New Testament tells us that three things remain: faith, hope, and love. Hope is one of the three lasting things in our Christian walk and experience. Hope is one of the three most important subjects in Christianity. Yet I can guarantee you this. I can guarantee that you've heard hundreds of sermons on faith if you've been part of a Bible-believing church for any length of time. I can guarantee you've heard people preaching about love on many an occasion. When was the last time you heard anyone preaching on hope? Not on faith, because some people think, well, faith, hope, yeah, they're the same thing. Well, they're not. They're obviously not the same. If faith and hope were the same thing, then 1 Corinthians 13:13 would say, these two things shall remain, faith, which is also called hope, and love. It doesn't say that. It says these three things remain, faith, hope, and love. In fact, have you ever heard anyone explain the difference in the Bible between faith and hope? Because I find when I talk to Christians, they fall into one of two errors. Either they see hope as just being a vague desire, like wishing I could win the lottery, or they actually get faith and hope confused and talk about them as if they're the same thing. And they're both errors. Because as we see from 1 Corinthians 13, hope is something real. It's something eternal and lasting. It's not something that goes away when the circumstances are fulfilled or not fulfilled. Hope remains. And not only that, hope is different from faith. So if you're looking at the biblical teaching about hope as just like, it'd be great if that happened, then you've missed the biblical teaching. And if you are thinking that, well, hope, it's just the same thing as faith, really, you've missed the biblical teaching. And that's why I'm asking, have you ever heard anyone actually explain the difference between faith and hope? Well, what is the difference? Well, yeah, it's not just we've said what it's not. It's not just a vague desire or a wish, because you don't hold unswervingly to a wish. And it's not just another word for faith, But hope is still linked to faith. There's a link and a connection. There's a relationship between faith and hope. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 says, "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see." Faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance in what we do not see. How does that fit together? Basically, hope stands on faith's shoulders. Hope is not less than faith. Well, I wish this would happen, but I don't really have enough faith that it will. That's not what hope means. Hope is more than faith. Hope's greater than faith. Now, not independently so, because it can't exist without faith, but it takes faith further. Hope stands on faith's shoulders. It is an extension of faith. You know, when I'm shooting videos, I put my camera up on a tripod, and the tripod has legs that extend up and down. And you can think of hope as being like that extension when the legs, you open up the little clip and the legs get longer, or like a telescope that is in parts and you're looking through the telescope and you want to look further, so you pull out the next segment and it goes further. That's what hope is like. Hope is an extension of faith. And the best definition that I can give you of the biblical definition of hope is this. Hope is an eager expectation of something in the future that you know by faith will happen. So faith, because you have faith, you know something is going to happen. But you know what? You can know something's going to happen and not be looking forward to it. You can know that something's going to happen by faith, and yet you may actually say, well, I don't really want it to happen. Or you may be looking forward, and in faith, you know it's going to happen, but you're just really not that bothered about it. It's not that important to you. But hope is where you know by faith that something is going to happen, and you're looking forward to it with an eager expectation. Like a child looking forward to Christmas. The child knows Christmas is going to take place. It's not going to be cancelled. My goodness, we've been through a year where everything else has been cancelled, but Christmas wasn't cancelled. So a child knows Christmas is going to take place. Now, if they just had faith that Christmas was going to take place, they'd be, yeah, it's going to be Christmas on the 25th of December, so what? But there's not many children like that. Most children are looking forward to the 25th of December. Why? Because they don't just have faith that Christmas is going to take place, but they look forward to it with hope, with an eager expectation. And it's that Christmassy expectation feeling. That's what hope is in the Bible. It is looking forward based on faith, looking forward to something that you know is definitely going to happen, but you're looking forward with eager expectation. Now, you may be listening to that definition. You say, hang on, Nick, you're saying that hope is definitely going to happen. So you're saying we don't hope for things that don't happen. Well, using the word in its ordinary English language way, yeah, you know, the way we use hope today in the English language, we like things to happen and sometimes they don't happen and we get disappointed. But biblical hope is not disappointed. Romans chapter 5. Listen to this. It's going to start very familiar, and then it's going to talk to us about hope. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. There you've got faith, you've got grace, and you've got hope. Three crucial but separate and distinct Christian concepts. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. So hope comes from having biblical character. Hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. And when it says there, hope does not put us to shame, Other translations say hope does not disappoint. You know, the translation I normally use when I'm preaching, and that we use when we put graphics up on the screen in church, is the New International Version of the Bible. It's what we call a dynamic equivalence translation. It's not always word for word as precise as some translations, but it keeps the flow of the language. And it's good for reading in church because it's easily followed and easily understood. But when you're doing personal Bible study, it's good to use a translation which is more word. Now, best, of course, is if you can take the time to learn Hebrew and Greek. But if you can't do that, you can use a word for word translation which carries more of the shades of meaning. And probably one of the best word for word translations is the New American Standard Bible. And the NASB translates Romans 5:5 as hope does not disappoint. In other words, when you have real hope, not a faint wish, but a biblical hope based on faith, then it will not disappoint. It's not going to let you down. It's not going to leave you shrugging your shoulders and saying, gosh, I was looking forward to that and it didn't happen. If it is biblical hope, and based and founded on biblical faith, then it's going to bring a biblical positive result. Because hope, real hope from God, does not disappoint. When you have biblical hope, then you become like a dog with a bone. And just think about that. A dog with a bone does not want to relinquish that bone for any reason. The dog's going to be determined. The dog's going to hang on. The dog's not going to let go. Why? Because he's got joyful expectation for what he's going to do with that bone in the future. He's going to gnaw on that bone. He's going to crunch it. He's going to get bits of meat that are still remaining off it. He's going to get right through to the marrow inside. You know, we keep Old English sheepdogs. We've on our third one now in our house, and they've got big, strong jaws. Oh, they love a bone. But don't try to pull a bone out of their jaws. They won't let go. A dog with a bone doesn't want to let go because it's full of hope, a joyful expectation of what it's going to get from that bone. When God gives you a biblical hope in something, you're not going to let go. You're like a dog with a bone. This church, Solid Rock Drogheda, is built on biblical hope. Can I tell you, 27 years ago, so I was planting this church, I was like a dog with a bone. I knew God had called us here. We'd had prophetic word. We'd had things had come together in such a way that I would need to be spiritually deaf and blind not to know that God was going to plant a church here in Drogheda. And I was like a dog with a bone. I wouldn't let go. No matter what the discouragement, time after time, our buildings that we were in, we were kicked out of the buildings we were using. When we were in our services, there was only tiny numbers of people. So, sometimes we had people sat heckling me while I preached. I actually was sent death threats telling me not to plant a church in Drogheda. We had people breaking into our premises and stealing things. We had people stealing money out of the offering baskets during the services. We had people stealing people's cars from outside the service. We had people breaking into people's cars and stealing the radios. We had lies and slanders told about us. My daughter died only a few months into planting this church. All kinds of pressures, everything that could have stopped it was thrown at us. But we're still here. My own denomination that I belonged to at the time turned on me, and the superintendent of that denomination tried to rubbish and destroy the church that we were planting here in Drogheda. And yet we're still here, because I was like a dog with a bone. And thank God, God put other people alongside me who are like dogs with bones. We wouldn't let go. And despite all human expectations today, we have a worshiping church of people from over 40 different nationalities worshiping God here in Drogheda. Why? Because of a biblical hope. Because God gave us a hope, and hope does not disappoint. And so we were like a dog with a bone with it. That's why the word hope is used so much to do with last things, what theologians called eschatology. You know, when they're talking about heaven and eternity and the second coming of Jesus, these things are a hope. We know they're going to happen. We don't have any doubt about it. We're not saying, well, maybe Jesus will return. We know he's going to return. We've got the faith for that. But we go beyond faith to hope, to eager expectation for these things. And even when we stand by a grave and face that horrible opponent called death that has touched our lives or the lives of people we love, you know what? We're still full of hope. That's why the Bible says that we are not like those who mourn as with no hope. Think about that. To be without hope, to be hopeless, doesn't mean that you don't believe something will happen. But it can mean that you know fine well it will happen, but you have no eager expectation about it. You know, people who don't know Jesus know that death will come. They're not deluded into this, that they think they're going to live to be 300 years old. They know death will come, but they have no hope. There's no eager expectation because they don't have the biblical hope of eternity that we have. Can I tell you, the world is full of hopeless people right now. And the crisis that we've been living through for the last 14 months or more has left people hopeless. It has left people with mental health problems. It has left people fearful of what the future will hold, both to do with future pandemics that they don't know, they think maybe there's going to be another one down the line, maybe to do with the economy or whatever else. There's a lot of hopeless people out there. Do you know what the world needs now more than perhaps anything else? It needs a message of hope. It needs people of hope. The world needs churches of hope. Drogheda, County Louth, needs a people of hope. Drogheda needs a church full of hope. Well, how can we be those people? How can we be that church? How do you create hope? I want to very quickly give you 5 steps to being a person of hope. 5 steps to becoming a community of hope. Number one, cultivate Christ within you, because that brings hope. Colossians chapter 1, verse 27 says, to them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. I tell you, when everybody else around you is pessimistic, when everyone round about you is full of fear and gloom and doom, you need to be the person of hope. You need to be the person who's looking forward into the future with joyful expectation. And to do that, you've got to cultivate your experience of Christ in you. Because if you're born again, if you've received Jesus as your Savior, Christ is in you. If you haven't received him as Lord and Savior, you need to pause this online service. You need to hit the pause button and you need to get down on your knees and you need to say, Lord, would you please come into my life and would you change my life forever? I want to trust in the truth that Jesus died for me on the cross, that he rose from the dead, that he took my sins upon his shoulders, and I'm going to trust in him, and I'm asking you to come into my life so my life will never be the same again. And if you will do that, then I want to tell you that Jesus is there. He's in your heart. You have Jesus in you at all times. Christ in you, the hope of glory. And you know what? We need to cultivate that experience. We need to remind ourselves of that experience. We need to open up every area of our lives to the leading and the lordship of Jesus Christ. And when we do that, we truly become people of hope. And our church becomes a church of hope. Cultivate Christ in you. Step number 2 is live in the Word of God. You can't have too much of the Bible. You know, you'll know that when you're living in the Bible, because what happens is you're reading the Bible, you're memorizing verses, you're talking about it, you're thinking about it. You actually find biblical phrases begin to crop up more and more in your speech. You will actually talk, you know, when you talk, use phrases like the blind leading the blind, you know it's coming out of your knowledge of the word of God. These are biblical phrases. Psalm 119, verse 49 says, "Remember your word to your servant, for you have given me hope." You see, there's a link between the word of God and hope that God gives us. So if you want to be a person of biblical hope, if you want to be a person whose life is characterized by eager expectation of God fulfilling his promises, then you need to live in the word of God. Number three, become a person of praise. Psalm 71 verse 1 says, "As for me, I shall always have hope. I will praise you more and more." So if you want that hope in the Psalms, if you want that tikva, if you want an eager expectation in your life that will take your weight and hold you up when everything else seems to be falling away, then you need to become a person of praise. That means you don't just praise God when you're in church. You know, as we've reopened in this last week, can I tell you, we're still under some restrictions. We can't praise in just the same way we did before. I wish we could. I wish we could have 400 people in this building crammed shoulder to shoulder, everybody singing at the top of their voices. Instead, we have all these kind of restrictions. We have to put our singers, if they're legally, if our soloists in church are not going to wear a mask, they've got to stand behind a Perspex screen. That's why we've got these funny little screens behind me that you can see there. And we're told as well that we're not supposed to do congregational singing. Now, of course, that's not something I can police as a pastor because everybody's got masks on. So how am I supposed to see whether they're singing or not? So I'm not walking around policing that and telling people, pulling up the mask and saying, you're singing, you're not allowed to. We're not going to do that. But nevertheless, we feel those restrictions, and the singing in church is maybe not quite the same as it was before. And you know what? We can complain about that and give out about that and whinge about that and say how bad the government are for having these restrictions still in place. Or we can actually become a person of praise. And that means you don't need to be in the church building to praise God. You don't need to be in the midst of a congregation to praise God. You'll be singing out praises to God when you're in your kitchen. You'll be singing out praises to God when you're driving the car. You'll be singing out praises to God when you're on the toilet. You could actually, echoes sometimes sounds better in there. But you will be praising God in all circumstances because you will be a person of praise. So if you want to be a person of hope, stop whinging about how you're not allowed to sing in certain places and start singing in the places where you are allowed to sing. And be a person of praise. Because when you're a person of praise, you become a person of hope. You become a person whose life is characterized by joyful expectation. Number four, remember the goodness of God. In the book of Lamentations, you know straight away when you call a book Lamentations, it's not going to be a cheerful book. You wouldn't expect to find a lot of hope in Lamentations. And sure enough, it was written whenever Jerusalem was destroyed and everybody was down. Everyone was hopeless, apart from the author of Lamentations, who's Jeremiah. Because he says this in Lamentations chapter 3, verse 21. "Yet this I call to mind, therefore I have hope." But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. "Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord." And there, in the midst of devastation and defeat, you have, in the midst of that desolation, you have hope. Hope that is based on saying, "I will call this to mind. I will remember the goodness of God. Therefore, I will have hope. You need to constantly be reminding yourself of the goodness of God. You know, I tell a lot of stories when I preach, stories about where I was, things that happened, things that God has done in the life of the church. And one is I like to tell stories. I am one of life's storytellers. I love a good story. But you know what I've discovered? Stories are also a great way to share truth. That's why Jesus told stories, of course. I'm part of a national campaign that's been put together for next year, an evangelistic campaign that's called What's the Story? Because there's a power in a story. But I also tell stories because I'm reminding myself of the goodness of God. Because every time I remind myself of what God has done for us in the past, then I'm filled with hope, with eager expectation that God will do in the future what he has promised already to do. So remember the goodness of God. And step number 5, exercise mental discipline. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13 says, "Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming." Now, a literal translation of that would actually say, "Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind and be sober. Set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming." Gird up the loins of your mind. You can see why some modern translations just say, be alert and sober, because that's a peculiar phrase. What does it mean to gird up your loins? Well, your loins were actually the side of your body, basically from the middle of your torso down to your hip. That's the loins, okay? Sometimes people think loins is talking about another area of your body. It's not. And so your loins were the side of your body. And what it referred to was that in the days whenever people wore tunics and robes, if they were preparing themselves for battle, they would bunch up their tunics and their robes and tuck them in the folds into their belts at the sides of their torso where their loins are. And when you girded up your loins, you were ready for battle. The Bible says we've got to gird up the loins of our mind. So yeah, be alert. Yeah, it does mean that, but it means more than that. It means get rid of distractions. It means get focused. Get focused on the one thing that really matters. When you're in a battle, you know, you're not worrying about whether there's creases in your garment. You are concerned about coming out alive from that battle, about winning it. And in the same way, when you gird up the loins of your mind, then what you're saying is this: I am going to concentrate. I am going to blot out distractions. And I am going to allow the hope of God to move through me in joyful expectation. Sometimes you need to take those wandering distractions and those doubts and those fears, and you need to push them away. Gird up the loins of your mind for battle. And you do that by concentrating on the eager expectation, the hope of what God is about to do. So there you have 5 steps to being a person of hope. 5 steps to ensuring that this church is a community of hope. Cultivate Christ in you. Live in the Word. Become a person of praise. Remember the goodness of God. And exercise mental discipline to concentrate on being a person of hope. May God help us to do that. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray that we will not just be hearers of the Word, we will be doers of the word. Lord, I want to live as a person of hope. I want to be part of a church that is a community of hope. Help us to walk deeper and deeper into that divine calling. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Just want to share with you a couple of notices, and after that we'll close by saying the grace together. We've started online services. If you haven't been able to be with us this Sunday and you're close enough to come next Sunday. Okay, you can book your seats for next week on our Eventbrite link, which is up. It'll be up by 8 o'clock tonight, Sunday night, on the website, solidrock.ie, or on our Facebook page, Solid Rock Drogheda. Meanwhile, the private prayer is not going to be continuing in the church building now that we've returned to Sunday services, but our online services are continuing. So we have our physical services here on a Sunday morning at 10 a.m. and 12 noon, but also the online service will continue to go up online at 9 a.m. We are, of course, having our Wednesday night. We've changed the Wednesday night. So something new is starting this Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. online. It's called Upon This Rock, and it's a bit like the Wednesday night at the Rock we were doing before, but a bit different as well. There's going to be one song, and then there's going to be 15 minutes of teaching, and it's going to be verse by verse through a book of the Bible. So we're starting with John's Gospel, and we're going to start at John chapter 1, verse 1, and we're going to work through John's Gospel together. That's Upon This Rock this Wednesday, 7:30 p.m. online. And then Saturday, we have Children's Church online at 8 a.m., we mentioned Sunday service online as well, and also here physically. And also our Take Fives, our five-minute inspirational messages from Solid Rock Drogheda. They go up every day, Monday to Saturday, online. We've already mentioned the pre-marriage course. If you would like to be a part of that, then please do email courses@solidrock.ie. And we continue with our 24/7 prayer. Praise God. You know what? We're coming out of the crisis. But we're still going to keep on praying. Oh, I would love it so much if we could continue this prayer right through till Jesus comes back again. Wouldn't that be an incredible thing? I'm asking you to please, if you haven't already taken part, would you consider being part of our 24/7 prayer initiative? Go through the website, through the Facebook page, follow the links. And if you see a slot there that needs to be filled, why not try praying for an hour and see what God does in your life? And you can enter your name on there. Very easy to put your name on the rota. And also giving. Thank you for your giving to the church. We have boxes now here in the church building and on the back walls that you can put your tithes and offerings in there. And by the way, you know what? If you're somebody watching this online for the wrong reasons and you're thinking of breaking in, we empty the boxes every time we are in the building. So there's no money in them if you break in here whenever we're not here. So you can leave your tithes and your offerings in the boxes at the back of the church, or you can continue to give online. And of course, the numbers are on the screen. And there's also a PayPal link on our website that you can give that way as well. But we thank you for your faithfulness, and we keep moving forwards. You know what? We've come through an incredibly challenging time as a church, but we've come out the other end of it stronger than we went into it, because we are a church of hope, and you are a people of hope, and we are filled with joyful expectation. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen.